when this desire has conceived, it's been internalized, it gives birth to sin. One of the big lies that we go on believing again and again is that I can go so far and control this no further. I can think about this issue. I can allow my mind to be absorbed with it, but I'd never actually do it. Don't kid yourself.
Joshua reminds us that it's important to consider who leads us, and that we are to trust that God will put us in the right place at the right time for the right purpose. Today's message is called Sin in One Brings Defeat to All.
Good morning, and if you've got a Bible with you or can access one in the seat there, I want to read you from the book of Joshua, chapter 7. And we have been looking into this historical book of the Old Testament, the sixth book of the Old Testament, and learning some truths that are relevant, pertinent to our lives today, as the whole of Scripture is. Before I read you from chapter 7, I need to read you something from chapter 6. Chapter 6 records the conquering of the city of Jericho, which we looked at last time. And there is an important detail in the instructions that was given to the nation when they took the city of Jericho. that we passed over, made no reference to it all last week, but which is important to understand what I want to talk about this week, and contains an important truth that we will be sharing together. Because in chapter 6, verse 17, in giving instructions as to what to do when they enter the city, verse 17 says, "The city and all that is in it are to be devoted to the Lord. Only Rahab the prostitute and all who are with her in her house shall be spared, because she hid the spies we sent. But keep away from the devoted things, so that you will not bring about your own destruction by taking any of them. Otherwise, you will make the camp of Israel liable to destruction and bring trouble on it. All the silver and gold and the articles of bronze and iron are sacred to the Lord and must go into his treasury." Now let me take you to chapter 7 and verse 1. "But the Israelites acted unfaithfully in regard to the devoted things. Achan, son of Carmi, the son of Zimri, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took some of them. So the Lord's anger burned against Israel. Now Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is near Beth-Aven, to the east of Bethel, and told them, 'Go up and spy out the region.' So the men went up and spied out Ai. When they returned to Joshua, they said, 'Not all the people will have to go up against Ai. Send 2,000 or 3,000 men to take it, and do not weary all the people, for only a few men are there.' So about 3,000 men went up. But they were routed by the men of Ai, who killed about 36 of them. They chased the Israelites from the city gate as far as the stone quarries and struck them down on the slopes. At this, the hearts of the people melted and became like water. Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell face down on the ground before the ark of the Lord, remaining there until evening. The elders of Israel did the same and sprinkled dust on their heads." And we won't read the immediately following verses, which talk about how Joshua basically said to God, "God, why is it you give us the city of Jericho and we conquer it? We go against this little town of Ai and they beat us and we're driven back in defeat." Let me read now from verse 10. "The Lord said to Joshua, 'Stand up. What are you doing down on your face? Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They have taken some of the devoted things. They have stolen, they have lied, they have put them with their own possessions. That is why the Israelites cannot stand against their enemies. They turn their backs and run because they have been made liable to destruction. I will not be with you anymore unless you destroy whatever among you is devoted to destruction. Go consecrate the people. Tell them, 'Consecrate yourselves in preparation for tomorrow. But this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says: that which is devoted is among you, O Israel. You cannot stand against your enemies until you remove it.'" And then the next day, I'll just tell you what happened in the next few verses. The nation was brought before Joshua, and the tribe of Judah was singled out. And then the whole tribe was brought before Joshua, and the clan of the Zerahites were singled out. And then the clan of the Zerahites were brought before him, and the family of Zimri was singled out. And then the family was brought before Joshua, and the one man, Achan, was singled out from his family. And then in verse 19, "Joshua said to Achan, 'My son, give glory to the Lord, the God of Israel, and give him the praise. Tell me what you have done. Do not hide it from me.' Achan replied, 'It is true. I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. This is what I've done. When I saw in the plunder a beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. They are hidden in the ground inside my tent with the silver underneath. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran to the tent, and there it was, hidden in his tent with the silver underneath. They took the things from the tent and brought them to Joshua and all the Israelites and spread them out before the Lord. Then Joshua, together with all Israel, took Achan, son of Zerah, the silver, the robe, the gold wedge, his sons and daughters, his cattle, donkeys and sheep, his tent and all that he had, to the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, "Why have you brought this trouble on us? The Lord will bring trouble on you today." Then all Israel stoned him. And after they had stoned the rest, they burned them. Over Achan, they heaped up a large pile of rocks, which remains to this day. Then the Lord turned from his fierce anger. Therefore, that place has been called the Valley of Achor ever since. Israel has seen two dramatic interventions of God, the opening of the Jordan River when they crossed into the land, and then the capturing of the city of Jericho. And having captured Jericho, they now have a bridgehead into the land, and their task becomes now to occupy the whole land. And the next town they decided that was to be taken was the town of Ai. And Joshua sent some spies, check it out. They came back and said, "Look, there's not many people there. It's a small town. There are a few people." Said in verse 3, "And all the people have to go up against Ai. Send 2,000 or 3,000 men to take it, and don't worry all the people." So they sent these 3,000 men, and the men of Ai drove them back, thrashed them, killed about 36 of them, it says, and terrified the rest. When Joshua got this news, he fell face down before the ark of God, and he asked God, "Why did you lead us across the Jordan River so dramatically? Why did you give us the city of Jericho so dramatically? Only to lead us into defeat against this small town of Ai." By the way, when things go wrong, we're very prone to ask God why he didn't make things happen and to lay the responsibility at his feet. His answer basically was to say, "Joshua, stand up. You're looking in the wrong place. You're looking at the wrong person. Stand up and look at the people." Verse 11, "Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They have taken some of the devoted things, the things they were told not to touch. They have stolen, they have lied, they have put them with their own possessions. That is why the Israelites cannot stand against their enemies, and they turn their backs and run, because they've been made liable to destruction." And that's when the people are lined up, tribe by tribe, then clan by clan, then family by family, then person by person, and Achan is identified as the cause of their defeat in Ai. Now, what exactly went on here? I want to look at this story under three headings. I want to talk about the evil. By that I mean the sin, the poison that was clearly introduced into the national life of Israel and led to their national defeat. We'll talk about the evil. Then we'll talk about the effect, how this contaminated everybody and everything, and why. Then I want to talk about the end. That is, what came from this? What is the end of this event and story? Let's talk first then about the evil. What was it that Achan had done? And what happened was, as I read to you in chapter 6, when they took the city of Jericho, keep away from the devoted things, and there's certain things that were listed that the people must not touch because they were to be placed in the Lord's treasury, the silver, the gold, the articles of bronze and of iron. They are sacred. They belong to God. Don't you take them with you. And everyone observed that except this man, Achan. And in verse 20, this is what I've done. When I saw the plunder, a beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. They're hidden in the ground inside my tent with the silver underneath. In that explanation Achan gives, running around the city, seeing the beautiful Babylonian robe that he took, seeing the silver and the gold glistening in the sunlight, he thought to himself, none of us have an inventory of how much is here. Nobody will know something's missing. And he took some of those things that were devoted to God, and he hid them in his tent. And I want you to notice the development of his explanation. It is a development that will ring a bell, I think, in your heart, as it certainly does in mine. He says, when I saw the plunder, I coveted them. That was the first thing. And he says, I took them. That was the second. And I hid them. That was the third. Firstly, he says, when I saw them, I coveted them. I saw the plunder, in the plunder, beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels. I coveted them. You see, sin always starts with a desire. Essentially, it's greed. It's self-centered. It's purely about my own interest. Book of James talks about temptation in James 1, verse 14. And James writes, each one is tempted when by his own desire he is dragged away and enticed. And after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it's full grown, gives birth to death. There is a process there. It begins with desire. You can't always help that. You can't help desire suddenly coming into your mind over some issues. But when you entertain the desire, James says, you become dragged away. That is, when you entertain the desire, a temptation that may come to you, and you keep it, you hold on to it, it develops a life of its own. It has the power then to drag you. That drag seems to imply there's some measure of unwillingness, but you've allowed it to take root in your heart. It works away in your mind, in your heart, and it begins to drag you, and it becomes stronger than you, stronger than your ability to resist it. That is why covetousness, greed, lies at the root of so much sin. It is wanting what is not mine. It is wanting what I have no right to. It's wanting that which is forbidden to me. If it is in the material realm, it's wanting what belongs to someone else. You know, Paul wrote in 1 Timothy 6 and verse 10, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. This was Achan's initial interest. Here's some silver. Here's some gold. And this love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. I had a conversation one day this week with a businessman here in this city. And in the course of conversation, he's talking about some of the difficulties that he has. And he says, boy, is that verse ever true that says the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil? And some of the struggles that he's facing are because of the love of money that he sees that causes people to break their own rules. Many have been sucked into this trap. It's one thing to break the rules of the land. It's one thing to break the rules that God has given to us. But when you start breaking your own rules, you are beginning to destroy your own self and your own integrity. If it's in the sexual area, it's wanting what is not belong to us. Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 28, I tell you, anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. It's not the first look that is lustful. You can't help the first look. It's the second look that becomes lustful, because the second look, then you give access and it begins to take root. And Achan says, I saw, but so did everybody else, and I coveted then. That's the problem. Problem wasn't seeing. Problem was I began to covet. I began to say to myself, if I could get away with this, if I could have this and there'd be no consequences, I want it. That's the first thing. I coveted then, says Achan. The second thing in verse 21, he says, I coveted them and took them. You see, once covetousness has been given room to put down its roots and begin to grow, we have usually lost the battle at that point. It's extremely difficult to take it back after that. That's why James, in his comment that I just quoted, says, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. So when this desire has conceived, taken root, this desire has become internalized rather than knocking it on the head at the beginning and destroying it at the beginning and turning away at the beginning, you've allowed it to be accommodated. When this desire has conceived, it's been internalized, it gives birth to sin. One of the big lies that we go on believing again and again is that I can go so far and control this and no further. I can think about this issue. I can allow my mind to be absorbed with it, but I'd never actually do it. Long before anybody commits a particular sin, whatever it may be, that is of significance and it is destructive in their lives, you talk with them and you trace back long before they ever committed the actual sin itself. They'd played around with the idea, thinking, I can handle this. Remember hearing an African man tell a typical African story one day. I love African stories. And he said in this particular country, there was a law that says you must not eat porcupine. I guess they were protected. Who would want to eat porcupine anyway? But anyway, that was the law. You must not eat porcupine. And in this story, a man was out hunting porcupine and somebody said to him, you must not eat porcupine. It's against the law. No, no, I'm not going to eat porcupine. I'm just hunting porcupine. And then he shot a porcupine. Somebody said, the law says you must not eat porcupine. No, I'm not eating porcupine. I just shot a porcupine. There's no law that says that. Then he tasted the porcupine. Somebody came by and said, there's a law that says you must not eat porcupine. I'm not eating it. I'm just tasting it. That's all. I'm just tasting it. Next time somebody came by, he'd eaten the porcupine. Of course he had. But you know, we play that game. That's why Jesus said the issue is not adultery. The issue is lust. You think you can play with your lust and contain it. Don't kid yourself. When it's conceived, it gives birth to sin. And what has happened with Achan is that he saw and coveted, and the conceived idea, I took it. But the third thing he says, I hid them in the ground. They are hidden in the ground inside my tent. Let me tell you this. Once you begin to engage in a particular sin, I'm not talking about the sins of omission that we're all guilty of, but some particular area in which there has been temptation like this to violate what you know is right, you will hide it. And anything you need to hide, you can be sure has poison in it. If you have to hide it, it's poisonous. And you cannot bring poison into your life, and everything's going to be okay. When Achan hid his sin in his tent, what the fool had not realized is he is bringing this right into the bosom of his family. And its effect is going to come out in his family as well, as it does. What fools we are when we think that sin can be hidden and buried. It's under control. It's domesticated. I can put it in a hiding place, shut the door, and it passively lies there dead. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. It still does its work. There's a verse in the Old Testament, a phrase in Numbers 32, verse 23, it says, "Be sure your sin will find you out." Listen carefully to that verse. Not be sure other people will find you out. Not be sure your wife will find you out. Not be sure your kids will find you out. Not be sure your husband will find you out. Not be sure your friends will find you out. Not even be sure the law will find you out. Your sin itself will find you out. Your sin itself, having been hidden, is not passive. It is toxic. It is actively destructive. And whether the nature of sin, of the sin, is known or not, the effect of that sin will spread out. And whether anybody identifies it, and you keep up an appearance and everything seems fine, there will be the bad smell in your family, in your workplace. That's why Achan's family was brought into this inquisition. That's why his clan was brought into the inquisition. That's why his tribe. That's why the whole nation felt the negative power of his sin and its weakness and it being defeated. We are foolish if we believe we can isolate and domesticate our sin. That we can hide it and it'll stay hidden. No, it doesn't. It doesn't. Its effects seep out. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 2 and verse 16, "In the day when God would judge men's secrets through Jesus Christ, as my gospel declares." Men's secrets, that which is hidden, that which is concealed, that which is covered up, it will be exposed, and the gospel declares that, and we'll see in a moment why it's such a good thing, that it eventually is brought to light. That's the evil, that's the sin, that's the poison that is in this story. I coveted them. I took them, I hid them. Anything you have to hide, it's dangerous. Secondly, the effect. And the effect, of course, permeates the whole nation. The Lord said to Joshua, notice this, Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They have taken some of the devoted things. They have stolen. They have lied. They have put them with their own possessions. That is why the Israelites cannot stand against the enemies. Notice all that's in the plural. It's about the Israelites. They, five times he says, they have lied. They have hidden. They have stolen. You see, in this instance, sin in one person brings defeat into the whole nation. Undergirding the military tactics of Joshua, and you read through the book of Joshua, he was a brilliant tactician. Undergirding the military tactics was his moral integrity and that of the nation, and the spiritual life and integrity of the nation. It doesn't mean that the lowest common denominator rules. One person out of fellowship with God brings destruction to everybody else necessarily, or defeat to everybody else. But there's a context to this. In a situation of victory, when God is at work and God is doing some wonderful things, as he has been in the previous chapters, one person can destroy that. So in verse 13, you cannot stand up against your enemies until you remove it, because the sin in one man is bringing defeat to the whole nation. And that is in a situation where there is victory, where God is at work. But if that is true, sin in one man can bring defeat to the whole nation, the reverse is also true. In a situation of defeat, victory in one person can bring victory to the whole nation. And there are several examples of this, and one of the most clear examples was that occasion when David went to meet Goliath, you remember, when the Philistines and Israel were at war, and the Philistine leader said, if one person from your side will fight one person from my side, the winner will be the winner of the war. And he was Goliath, and he was a giant, and Saul accepted the challenge but couldn't find a man anywhere who would take on Goliath. And for 40 days, they are humiliated as Goliath taunts them every day. Where's your man? And they feebly respond, we're just looking for him. Try to bribe somebody to go into battle. One day, David, a boy too young to be a soldier, looking after sheep, came into the camp to bring some barley and some bread and some cheese to his brothers. And he said, why aren't you fighting? They told him about the challenge of Goliath. And David went to see Saul, who was king. And David knew Saul because he used to play his harp when Saul was uptight, and it calmed him down a bit. And so Saul knew David, even though he was just a boy, and he went to see him. And he said, isn't God on your side? David, you have to be realistic in these situations, you know. You've got to be practical. David said, this man is not challenging you. He is challenging God. Nobody else will go. I'll go. Saul said, you can't do that. Oh, yes. So I've been out with my sheep when nobody's looking, out in the hillside looking after sheep, and a lion came, and I attacked the lion, killed it, when it took a sheep in his mouth, and then a bear came and attacked the sheep, and I took the bear and I killed the bear. And that was with no audience. I wasn't impressing anybody. I was just on the hillside with my sheep, and God who delivered me from the bear and God who delivered me from the lion would deliver me from this giant. By the way, David had learned and proved God in secret on the hillside just with his sheep. No audience to impress, just alone with the sheep. And you don't leapfrog into seeing God work in any marvelous way, other than when in the private, unseen area of your life, you're bringing God in. Nobody's perfect. We're never offered perfection. We'll never be perfect. But we bring God into those areas of struggle and battle, a lion. And the devil's like a lion in the New Testament, like a roaring lion, like a lion, like a bear. You say, God, I'm out of my depth in this. And you discover his strength and victory. And he says to Saul, nobody else will go, I'll go. He didn't dress in armor, though he was offered. He took 5 stones and a sling, went to meet Goliath and said, you come at me with sword and spear and javelin. I come in the name of the Lord, of God of the armies of Israel. And he said, the end of this day, all in Philistine territory and Israel will know there's a God in Israel. And he took his stone, slung, hit glass on the forehead, dropped to the floor. David ran up, took his sword, cut off his head. And it says the whole Israelite nation got up and they chased the Philistines down to Gath, which is where they came from. In a situation of defeat, victory in one man is enough to bring victory to the nation. But in a situation of victory, defeat in one man is enough to bring defeat to the nation. You know, I've been to speak in churches, and I've been to speak in situations where you sense right from the beginning, there's something not right here. I remember being in one church years ago, and saying, are you sure things are right here? Yeah, I think, yeah, we have normal things, but yeah, it's fine. Well, maybe it's just me. But it was like swimming in syrup, trying to preach in that context. And a year or so later, something came out that devastated that church that had been there, buried, but let out a bad smell. Something's wrong. And you see, you're not irrelevant to what God is doing around the place. If you're a child of God, you're in union with Christ. You're part of a body. It's no good my hand saying, I'm irrelevant to what goes on the rest of the body. I'm gonna just take a day off, stick myself in a pocket and not come out for a week. How do you think my body's gonna be affected? And that's why in the defeat of the nation and the humiliation of that defeat, God says to Joshua, we cannot simply override this. We have got to face it. We've got to bring it out. The nation is involved, so bring the nation. Identify from that nation the tribe. They identify the tribe of Judah, and then the clan, and then the family, and then the man. But the whole gamut of life had to come before Joshua because it was all affected. And the third thing is the end. What is the end of this? What happens as a result? It's first bad and then it's good. I'll show you what is bad. Verse 25, then all Israel stoned him. And after they'd stoned the rest, that was his family, they burned them. And over Achan, they heaped up a large pile of rocks, which remains to this day. Then the Lord turned from his fierce anger. Therefore, that place has been called the Valley of Achor ever since. The judgment of God was upon Achan, and the discipline of God was upon the nation. He punished Achan. He disciplined the nation. Punishment and discipline are different. Punishment is an end in itself. Achan was no more. Discipline is remedial. It is painful, but it's designed to produce something better. What Achan would never have believed was that his whole family would die. You know, your family get caught up in your sin, and they drown with your sin. Don't think you can isolate and the family is going to be okay. If there's corruption and sin and disobedience and a hidden secret in your heart that's buried, but it's wrong and it's polluting. You know, a lot of people have difficulty with the judgment of God. Somehow they regard it as a slur on his otherwise good character. He's holy, he's just, he's righteous, but his judgment seems to be a problem. Of course it's not. God's judgment is part of his righteousness. It is part of his holiness. It is an expression of his love in actual fact. In the book of Hebrews 12, verse 6, quoting from Proverbs, actually, the writer says, the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. Part of being a son is that in his love, his father love, his paternal love towards us, he punishes sin and he disciplines those he loves. We need to be glad God is a God of judgment. We'd never know where we were otherwise. Campbell Morgan was a great preacher a century ago, over quite a long period of time, but he's around a century ago. He wrote some excellent books, of which I have a number. And Campbell Morgan wrote this, if you could persuade me that God could deal with sin lightly, you could, by that argument, prove to me that he is no lover of the human soul. Think about that. If you could persuade me God could deal with sin lightly by that very argument, you could prove to me he's no lover of the human soul. It's because he is love that he judges. This is why the cross of Jesus Christ is necessary and central to the Christian message. In the new covenant of which we are a part, all the judgment of God was poured on his Son. And that judgment was met in full. If you want to know what God thinks of sin, look at the cross. There you will see the judgment of God fully addressed and fully satisfied. If you want to know what God thinks of you, look at the cross. There you will see the love of God fully demonstrated and fully satisfied. And we live under the new covenant, where all the judgment of God on our sin has been meted out on Christ. But it is only dealt with, that judgment only becomes the means of our freedom and liberty when we bring our sin out of hiding and we confess it. I've said this many times before, the only way sin leaves our body is through our mouth. Not concealing it, exposing it. If we confess our sin, bring it out into the open, and we cannot separate the judgment of God from the love of God. I was just looking at a book this week, as somebody gave me last week, that kind of sets these up as opposites, and how do we reconcile a judging God and a loving God, you know, and he tries to explain that he really isn't a judging God at all. He's really a loving God, but God himself is not the objective judge. And he selectively picks some verses to try and persuade us that God is a lot nicer than we sometimes think he is. God is to be feared. He is love, but he is judge. And his judgment is meted out on Achan. And sadly, but realistically, his family become contaminated in the judgment. Because we don't sin alone. I said there was something that's not so pleasant and something that's good in the way the story ends. Chapter 7 ends, therefore that place where he was stoned and his family was stoned, therefore that place has been called the Valley of Achor ever since. It was named after Achan. And this place and this event is referred to later in the Old Testament in the book of Hosea. And Hosea writes in Hosea 2 and verse 15, it's God speaking, I will make the valley of Achor a door of hope. Hosea's circumstance was that his wife Gomer had become an adulteress. They had three children. And she began to slide down further into increasing sexual promiscuity until she ends up selling her body on the street. She became so devalued that Hosea bought her back at half price of a slave and took her back home. God said to Hosea, this hurts you, doesn't it? That's how I hurt with my people Israel. They committed adultery with other gods and Baals and Asherah poles. And so if you read chapter 2 of Hosea, he says to Hosea, rebuke her. She'll become like a desert. She'll be dry and dead and fruitless. But then God says this, but I will allure her. I will speak tenderly to her. I will draw her back and I will make the valley of Achor, that is the judgment on her, I'll make the valley of Achor a door of hope. Hosea, the discipline of God is not a door of despair. It's actually a door of hope because he judges and disciplines those he loves. And the judgment of God and the discipline of God becomes a door of hope. The hope is this, that my sin can be dealt with. My sin can be removed. The defeat that is permeated into other people's lives around me, as it happened for Achan and certainly happened with Gomer in Hosea's family life, that defeat and that poison and that humiliation of exposure and discovery and being found out, that this becomes a door of hope, because when it wakes you up to the truth and you bring it out to the surface, God can do something with it. A picture of the potter in the book of Jeremiah, when a potter is molding the clay and the clay goes wrong, he molds it into another pot that seemed good to him. Not the same pot. You'll always be affected by our sins. But God will mold us in something that seems good to him. Don't lighten your sin. Don't by this say, phew, that means to say, oh God, I'm sorry about it. Please, you know, make something good out of this. No, sometimes the process of dealing with our sin is a painful one. We've got to bring them out. And as we do so, we find a door of hope. And the discipline of God, which is an expression of the love of God, will yield the peaceable fruit of righteousness, a phrase that Paul uses. If you're a victim of an Achan, there's some sin, the poison of which has permeated into your life. We have to be bold and bring that to the light. We need to confront because we care enough, and because we love enough. And together bring it to the cross, if it's in your marriage, if it's in your family, if it's in some other context. You bring it to the cross and you see the judgment of God on it, and you see that judgment is severe. Because the sin is severe. But out of that judgment on the Lord Jesus Christ, we can find forgiveness and not look for revenge, but we can find hope. I'll make the valley of Achor a door of hope. Let me finish by just reading chapter 8 and verse 1. When they had stoned Achan, named the valley of Achor. The next verse, which is chapter 8 and verse 1. Then the Lord said to Joshua, do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. Take the whole army with you and go up to attack Ai, for I have delivered into your hands the king of Ai, his people, his city, and his land. You've dealt with it now, you've brought it out. And God says, don't be discouraged. Don't sit under a cloud over this now. You've brought it out. You've exposed it. You've dealt with it. Don't be discouraged. Go back to the very area of your defeat and find there God will be active. God will be present. I have delivered, past tense, what to you is yet future tense, I have delivered Ai into your hands. Defeat is never final unless you keep it all hidden. You have to bring it out. confess to one another. That's part of the process of bringing it out. And find a cleansing and a freedom. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, I do pray for everyone here, and we all stand before you, aware of our need, aware of those areas of our lives that we thought we could contain, but we can't. We confess, Lord Jesus, that we feel we're living distant from you, powerless, weak, because we've never had the courage to deal with the issue that is crippling us. Give us the courage, we pray. Thank you that you will give us the grace. Thank you that though discipline may seem painful for a while, it will produce the fruit of righteousness. And in this valley of Achor, there is a door of hope. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Someone who would benefit from this message. Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in next week for a new message from Charles and Hillary's Holy Land series, No Longer a Stranger. It's awesome to know God keeps His promises. The book of Joshua shows how God wants to give us an inheritance into which we are to enter and enjoy. In this series, Joshua, Living Your Inheritance, we are reminded that it's important to consider who leads us, and that we are to trust that God will put us in the right place, at the right time, for the right purpose. This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. Also available is a special offer of the Bible guide, Discovering Joshua by Charles Price. To order this series, write to the address on your screen or call 1-416-222-3341, extension 155. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. The inheritance given by God is ours to enter and enjoy.
King of my life, I crown you now. Thine shall the glory be, lest I forget your thorn crown brow. Lead me to Calvary. Show me the tomb where you were laid, tenderly mourned and wept. Angels in robes of light array guarded you while you slept. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me, lead me to Calvary. Led me like Mary through the gloom. Come with a gift for thee. will show to me now the empty tomb. Lead me to Calvary, and may I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for thee. Even your cup of grief to share, for you have borne all for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget your agony, lest I forget your love for me, lead me to Calvary. Jesus, lead me. Oh, lead me to Calvary. To Calvary.